Hello there, everyone. I'd like to introduce you to Martin. He's a chemist, and like most working adults, when he gets up in the morning, his energy levels are pretty low. So let's take a look at how his energy levels change over the course of the day. And I promise you, we'll get to color soon enough. When he gets up, he's kind of groggy and doesn't have much energy. We'll represent that with this line. So he reaches for his nearest cup of coffee, and the caffeine causes his energy levels to spike. He's excited to start the day and heads off to work. Now at work, he spends some time applying for grants, which drains his energy just a little bit. Then he heads down to the lab, where he spends a good portion of his day until boom, that 2:30 feeling hits. He manages to get through the day with the energy he has remaining. Now you might be asking yourself, what in the world does that have to do with color? But bear with me. Remember that atoms contain dense nuclei with surrounding electrons. When they bond together to form molecules, those electrons are shared among the molecule. And just like we can talk about a person's energy levels, we can talk about the energy of a molecule, which is made up of three main characteristics: the energy of its electrons, its vibrations, and its rotations. Like we looked at Martin's energy levels earlier, let's take a look at a molecule's energy levels. It starts out low, which is what we call a ground state. Just like caffeine could raise Martin's energy levels, light can raise the energy levels of the electrons in the molecule to what we call an excited state. Through rotations and vibrations, the molecule relaxes and some of that energy is dissipated. There are a few different ways that the molecule can relax further. In one case, the electrons relax and emit a photon of light, a process called fluorescence. However, the relaxation of a molecule can get pretty complicated, so we're going to save that for another video. Instead, let's go back and focus on electrons and this absorption process. Here's where color gets involved. Whereas Martin's energy levels could vary continuously, that is, it could be anywhere along this line, the energy levels of a molecule and its electrons are discrete. They can only be at certain levels, not everywhere between. Therefore, an electron can only absorb light with the exact amount of energy that gets it from its ground state to its excited state. Remember that white light is actually composed of colors corresponding to the colors of the rainbow, and each color has a different energy. If the transition from a ground state to the excited state is equal to the energy of blue light, for example, the electrons will absorb blue light and reflect the rest of it. Such a compound would look orange. For you art buffs, it's easy to remember what color a compound is, as it looks the color which is complementary to the one it absorbs. Transition metals, those found in the middle of the periodic table, tend to be brightly colored because the transition between their electrons' ground states and excited states tend to absorb visible, colored light. Once again, you artists out there are already familiar with this. Colors such as cadmium yellow, cobalt blue, and chromium oxide green are all named for the metal compounds found in them. On the other hand, objects such as carrots and food dyes are colored because they contain organic molecules that are conjugated. These molecules have long patterns of alternating single and double bonds, and just like their metal counterparts, the energy between their ground states and excited states correspond to visible light, giving them color. Thanks for watching this video, and be sure to subscribe to the Everyday Elements channel on YouTube and like the Facebook page. If you have any comments or suggestions for future videos, feel free to reach out. In our next video, we'll discuss why it's perfectly okay for there to be cyanide in your table salt.